Hey hockey players, Coach Garner here from hockeytraining.com. In this video, I want to answer the question of should you go to hockey when you're sick? A lot of hockey players ask themselves this question, I'm feeling a little bit under the weather, should I go, should I not go, should I stay hardcore and go no matter what, or should I stay home and use this time to recover? There's typically two camps. One camp that says, F it, I'm gonna go no matter what, and then the other camp leans on the side of recovery. Now, when you look into the science, you find a very deep and interconnected relationship between exercise and the immune system function. But before we get into any of that stuff, we gotta go through the number one rule. And the number one rule is don't show up to hockey or the gym if you know you're contagious, okay? If you know you're contagious, don't show up. I don't wanna be around somebody who's sick and contagious. You don't wanna be around somebody who's sick and contagious, so don't show up. Especially in the hockey arena where it's cold in the air, you're going to be around a lot of people, there's going to be physical contact, you can get your own team ill. And now not only are you ill, but a lot of other players on the team could be ill, and then you drive down performance of the entire team for who knows how long, and not just yourself. So think about more than just yourself and think about the team in that kind of a scenario. I know your mind's in the right place and you only wanna come to help out, but if you got it from someone in your family and they got it from someone else and it's spreading like wildfire right now, something hyper contagious, just stay home. You'll be doing your whole team a favor. But getting into a little bit of the actual literature between immune system function and exercise, we've got our rules for when is an okay time to go and when is it not an okay time to go, and is it even going to be beneficial if I do show up, or should I actually stay home and recover? Well, we've got our neck up and our neck down rule, and here's how it works. If your illness is purely from the neck up, you are cleared to go exercise, period. But if your illness resides from the neck down, then you gotta stay home. And this is something to do, we've seen this before with marathon runners with upper respiratory tract infections, but if you have something from the neck up, essentially a dry cough or a stuffy nose or maybe headaches, that is actually from an immune system and exercise standpoint, you're cleared to go exercise. So that's something that won't impact your overall recovery reserves. And provided you're not contagious, it's something that can actually help you move forward in your hockey career, get still more progress from the gym, and recover with no problem. But from the neck down, if you have a lot of congestion in the chest, if you've got a lot of phlegm in your lungs, or if you have nausea in your gut, or if you're going to the bathroom, number two, a million times, this is where there is a lot of what's known as immunocompromise, and your immune system is not prepared to deal with the wear and tear from exercise or the wear and tear from the game, because it's dealing with the wear and tear from the current infection that it's fighting through, whether it be bacterial or viral, doesn't matter. Neck down, don't train or go to hockey. Neck up, you are cleared from a physiological standpoint to go partake even in intense activity. Got it? That's the neck up and neck down rule. Now, what should we actually do when we start feeling very ill? We know something's coming on and we still want to go train, but we don't know if we should do it or not. Well, over 10 years ago, I actually made an observation myself that I'm very proud of. I made an observation to where if I went to the gym and I trained really hard and I knew I was kind of feeling ill, it would actually make things a lot worse. That my gym session wasn't very productive. I wouldn't really ever recover from that session. I didn't feel like I made progress from that session. I just felt generally crappy. But if I went to the gym and I trained with a moderate intensity and a moderate duration, those are two different factors in terms of immune system function, intensity and duration of exercise. If I did it moderately, I would actually feel better. And I would get better sooner than I otherwise would have. This is something I found out in my teen years and doing all the training way back when. It's cool enough, and luckily enough, the research actually caught up with it. And moderate exercise actually tends to stimulate immune system function, allow people to feel better, and allow people to get out of their sickness sooner than they otherwise would have. So it's something that I actually observed through intuition back in the day, but then the research came later and proved that what I was observing was correct. And that's something that's so important in the coaching world. It's not always what's measurable, it's also what's observable. That's the difference between a researcher and a coach. And I was very, very proud of that moment when the research caught up with it, because it's something I've been prescribing for a very long time. But long story short, that's the message. So when it comes to, hey, should I go to training? And if I do, should I alter my workout so that I actually get a benefit from it? Yes, but it's gotta be moderate intensity and moderate duration. So if you're gonna go to the gym and you wanna do cardio, it's gotta be aerobic based. You can't be doing sprints. So if you're feeling like something's coming on, what you're gonna do is you're gonna do a cardio session of about 20 to 30 minutes, and that cardio session should fall within 130 to 150 beats per minute, okay? 20 to 30 minutes or 20 to 40 minutes max per session, and your heart rate should be 130 to 150 beats per minute. That is a moderate length and a moderate intensity, and it's something that'll actually help you get better sooner, and it's also a workout that you can recover from and therefore adapt from and therefore gain progress from, okay? That's how you're gonna approach your cardio. As far as your high intensity interval training goes, absolutely freaking not, okay? Don't even think about it. You're not doing any sprints, you're not doing any bike sprints, you're not doing any hill sprints, you're not doing anything. I don't care. No Tabata protocol, no nothing. You're not doing any HIIT training whatsoever, because it is not moderate, and it's something that's gonna make you worse before you ever get better, which means less time on the ice, less time helping your team, and overall decreased levels of performance. No HIIT whatsoever. Weight training, on the other hand, weight training can be done, and it's another thing in the literature that can help get you better sooner than you otherwise would have. Cardio and weight training both get a massive check mark here. Well, I guess cardio got kind of a U. Let's turn that into a check mark. But weight training, you approach it in the same way. Moderate duration with moderate intensity. So what you would want to do is essentially weight train with a workout that is only about 20 to 40 minutes max in length, and then train very moderately, meaning never train to failure. Ever, 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 ever. If you are in illness, it's best to leave about 3 to even 5 reps left in the tank from your training session. So if I were to prescribe you a set of 12, I would want you to pick a weight that you could do for at least 15, but then still only do 12. This is gonna be enough to stimulate the anabolic stimulus from exercise, but not be too much to tap into the recovery reserves and causing immunocompromise, and therefore making exercise recovery nil and making illness recovery nil, okay? Very important that you keep a moderate length and moderate intensity for both your aerobic cardio, has to be aerobic, and your weight training, okay? That's how we're gonna approach these two if we're feeling something coming on, but there is a major, major, major caveat here. Okay, I've said the word moderate about 1,000 times now, but some people that falls on deaf ears. So the caveat here is that you have to have self-control. If you do not have self-control when you go to the gym, and I know that you're out there, then you cannot and should not go to the gym. Meaning, if you're somebody who has to do forced reps, who has to do negative reps, who feels like they just throw drop sets on the end of things for no reason at times to get a pump on and go to failure, none of this is for you. If you feel something coming on and you don't have the self-control to not hold back in cardio and not hold back in your weight training, then stay home, period. Because in your context, you are gonna make yourself worse 10 times out of 10, okay? And you adding all those intensification techniques that you think are helping you, they're not, because you're not gonna be able to recover from them, and then you can't adapt from them, and then you'll never make progress from them. So that's a major caveat. Training when ill, provided you're falling under all these rules and you're staying within the specifications that I provided here, that is only for the people who have real self-control. For the people who need to go for it, no pain, no gain kind of people, that's not for you. You gotta stay home. That's the major caveat. And if you want some boosters in the plan, vitamin C and L-glutamine have both been demonstrated to reduce your duration of illness, but only if you take it once you feel it coming on. It's very specific from a timing perspective. A lot of supplements out there, the timing doesn't actually really matter, but when it comes to preventing illness, it really does. So when you start feeling something coming on, anywhere from 10 to 20 grams of L-glutamine per day, preferably 10 grams in the morning, 10 grams in the evening, and then an additional 2 grams of vitamin C, preferably 1 gram in the morning, 1 gram in the evening. If you can do that, when you start feeling, everybody kind of gets that little bit of feeling or maybe a little bit of headache when they wake up, they feel a little heavier. When you feel that coming on, that's when you're gonna include the vitamin C and the glutamine. That's something that's gonna boost the immune system and allow you to get a far less duration. So if you would have been ill for say 7 days, this could bring it down to 3. It's very powerful stuff. And then if you add in the moderate exercise immunostimulation, could be even less. It's something that's actually allowed people to even bypass illness when you combine boosters with the proper recommendations and you're falling under the rules that I'm giving you here. Okay, that is the answer to should I go to hockey or should I train when I am sick, and is it even gonna be worth it? Thanks so much for watching this video. If you learned anything, you got any new tips and strategies that you can use now for the rest of your life when it comes to staying active, make sure you give me a thumbs up and subscribe to this channel. And for more information on hockey-specific nutrition and training programs, go to hockeytraining.com.